This time, we'll learn about the hydrate block package. There was a big change in the hydrate block package I used when I first created the lecture, so I decided to recreate the hydrate block chapter. And since the example at the time was too simple, I created a slightly more complex app while creating a new lecture. By definition, it is an extension package of the Flutter Bloc package, and its role is to be a package that automatically persists and restores the state of the block or qubit. Why do we need a package that does this? An app's state is volatile by default. In other words, if you reboot the app or perform a hard restart during app development, the state is reset. However, sometimes it is more desirable to retain the app's state after rebooting or hard restart as if the state was stored in a database. For example, if the state of the shopping cart within the app is persisted, it is not only convenient for the customers, but also from the store's perspective to increase the chance of purchase. And additionally, the app looks more professional. To maintain the state, persistent storage is required to save the state. But where should the persistent storage be located? If the state is stored in the remote storage may not be connected, and it may take a lot of time depending on the network situation. So there are some undesirable aspects as storage that maintains the state. So we need to use the local storage, that is, the storage of the device. As we know, apps can have a separate storage. And among the solutions that read and write to storage, it would be desirable to use a faster solution, right? Hydrate Bloc uses Hive, which is much faster than other local storage solutions like SQLite or Shell Preferences. Now that we know the basics of Hydrate Bloc, let's see how to use it. We'll learn how to use it while creating a simple app. I made a block hydrate app and installed the necessary package, Equatable, Flutter Bloc, and Hydrate Bloc, and the path provider package, and remove the comment of avoid print under the rules section of the analysis options.yml file. Let's see how the app we'll create this time works. In the middle of the screen is a text widget that displays a counter, and on the lower right side of the screen are four floating action buttons. The first floating action button toggles the theme of the app, the second floating action button increments the counter by one, and the third floating action button decrements the counter by one. The last floating action button clears the storage. The fourth floating action button clears hydrate blocks the storage, but does not reset the state. If you hard restart, you can see that the storage is cleared. I created a counter block and a theme block in the blocks folder. Since this chapter is going to focus on state persistency, the base code for the counter block and theme block has been created in advance. Let's start with the counter block first. Counter state is the same counter state you have seen many times. I created a counter state initial vector constructor that will be used as the initial state. The count state that initial vector constructor returns a count state instance with a count argument value of 0. The following is a counter related event. Increment count event increases the counter by 1, and decrement count event decreases the counter value by 1. Next, let's look at counter block. Counter state initial is given as the value of the initial state. When an increment counter event occurs, a new state is created by creating the value of the counter argument by 1 using the copied function of the state, and then emit it. When a decrement count event occurs, a new state is created by decreasing the value of the counter argument by 1 using the copied function of the state, and then emit it. Now let's look at the theme block. First is theme state. We plan to toggle the theme of the app between a light theme and a dark theme. I'll create an enum called appTheme and give light and dark as members. Next, I created the theme state class, created the final variable appTheme of appTheme type, and created the constructor, props, toString, and copy it. And appTheme.light was given as the default value of appTheme. Then I create a vector constructor called themeState.initial to be used as the initial state of theme block, and return the default constructor. In other words, it returns a theme state instance where the value of the appTheme argument is appTheme.light. Now let's look at theme event. Since we plan to change the theme every time the button is pressed in the app, there is no need for a separate argument for the event. Let's call that event a toggle theme event. Next is theme block. As the initial state of theme block, theme state.initial is given. Whenever a toggle theme event occurs, if the value of appTheme is appTheme.light, a new state with the value of appTheme is appTheme.dark is generated and emitted. Otherwise, generate a new state whose epitheme value is epitheme.light and emit it. Next, let's look at main.dot. In main.dot, we wrap the material app with multi-block provider so that we can use the counter block instance and theme block instance in the widget tree. Since the theme of the app needs to be changed according to the value of theme state, material app is wrapped with the block builder that has a theme block and theme state as types. Now, the value of theme is theme data.light if appTheme of theme state is appTheme.light, otherwise theme data.dark. Theme changes dynamically. Hydrate block was given to the title and the debug banner was not displayed. My homepage widget has been changed to stateless widget. A center widget was given to the body of the scaffold and a text widget displaying a counter value with font size 64.0 was given to the child. The change in counter value is listened to using the context.watch extension method. I assigned row widget to floating action button and gave main axis alignment.end to main axis alignment so that the buttons are displayed on the bottom right. As the first child, I created a floating action button that toggles the theme. In onPress callback, add method of theme block instance is called using context.read. At this time, the toggle theme event instance is given as an argument. As a second child, you create the floating action button that increments the counter value. In the onPress callback, the add method of the counter block instance is called using context.read. At this time, increment count event instance is given as an argument. As a third child, you create the floating action button that decrements the counter value. In the onPress callback, the add method of the counter block instance is called using context.read. At this time, decrement count event instance is given as an argument. As a last child, you create the floating action button to clear local storage. Currently, the onPress callback is an empty function. In this state, I ran the simulator to test. Pressing the leftmost button toggles the theme of the app between dark and light themes. The counter value increases when the plus button is pressed, and the counter value decreases when the minus button is pressed. The last clear button has not yet been implemented. If you perform a hard restart again, the state is reset. Let's take a look at the process of using Hydrate Block for a moment. First, we need to install the Hydrate Block and Path Provider packages. Of course, we also need to install the Flutter Bloc and the care of packages. In this case, the .data class generate extension is a great help in using the Hydrate Block. The next thing we need to do is tell the Hydrate Block where we need to store our state. As shown in the figure, the directory to be used for the storage directory of the Hydrate storage.build function is designated. You can specify a temporary directory as a storage location using the getTemporaryDirectory function, but it is not a safe option because the temporary directory can be deleted from the system. And save the return value of hydrateStorage.build function to hydrateBlock.storage. However, since the hydrateBlockStorage.build function calls the native code, the widget's Flutter binding that initialized the function is called first. Let's take a quick look at what we did in version 8.0. In version 8.0, as shown in the picture, we had to provide a run app as the callback of the hydrateBlockOverrides.runJoint function and give storage as a return value of hydrateStorage.build as a storage value. The hydrateBlockOverrides.runJoint function is a new function introduced in version 8.0 and was created because of a request to allow different storage to be used within an app. If you want to use other storage in another part of the app, you must call the hydrateBlockOverrides.runJoint function again in that part. However, as the hydrateBlock package version was upgraded to 9.0, hydrateBlockOverrides was removed. Changes to using hydrateBlock.storage instead. It went back to a similar way to how it was before version 8.0. The reason for making this change again is that the configuration that allows configuration per block by calling the runJoint function can cause complications. Please refer to the link for details. Next, apply the generate JSON serialization of the .data class generate extension to the state class to create the fromMap, toMap, fromJSON, toJSON functions. Next, if qubit or block has already been created, apply hydrate mixing, and if newly created, extend hydrate qubit or hydrate block. At this time, fromJSON and toJSON should be operating. FromJSON is used when the store of the state is needed, and toJSON is used when a new state is emitted. Now we are ready to go. The first thing we need to do here is telling the hydrate block package where it needs to store its state. However, this is a time-consuming task, so make a main function an async function. The location to save the state is specified using the hydrateStorage.build function, but hydrateStorage.build function calls the native code. For this reason, the function called widgetFlutterBinding that ensure initialized must be called first. If the app runs in the web environment, specify hydrateStorage.webStorage directory as the storage directory. Otherwise, use the application document directory as the storage directory. You can also specify a temporary directory as a storage location using the getTemporaryDirectory function, but this is not a safe option because the temporary directory can be deleted from the system. Save the return value of hydrateStorage.build function to hydrateBlock.storage. HydrateBlock is now ready to be used. First of all, we'll add the StorageClear function to the onPress callback of the false floating action button of MyApp. In the onPress callback, call the clear function of hydrateBlock.storage. Next, we'll do additional work using the .data class generate extension for the counterState class. In the .data class generate extension, there is a menu called generate JSON serialization. This menu adds from map, to map, from JSON, to JSON function to the counterState class. The from JSON and to JSON functions we commonly use have been created here with the name from map and to map. Strictly speaking, this name is more correct, but I will change it to a more conventional name. Let's change toMap to toJSON. Next, change fromMap to fromJSON, change the map argument to JSON, and change all maps inside the function to JSON. Next, delete toJSON and fromJSON below, and go to the top of the file and delete the .convert package import. Next, apply hydrate mixing to qubit or block that has already been made, or extend hydrate qubit or hydrate block when making qubit or block. Let's apply hydrate mixing to counter block. Then a red squiggle line is displayed in counter block. When I click the light bulb, it says create two mixing overrides. I will choose this. Then two function templates were created. The fromJSON function is called whenever the saved state is needed. It takes the data stored in JSON format, changes it back to counter state, and returns it. ToJSON function is called whenever a new state is generated. HydrateBlock saves in JSON format in the Hive. So, from the fromJSON function, it returns the countState created from counterState.fromJSON. Outputs the JSON received as an argument after saving the return value of counterState.fromJSON to the counterState variable, print it to the console before returning the value. Next, we return counterState. At ToJSON, it returns the state converted to a map. Print the state received as an argument. After saving the return value of state.toJSON in the countJSON variable, print it to the console before returning the value. Next, we'll return counterJSON. Next, we'll create toJSON and fromJSON in theme state. toJSON returns map data. By the way, fTheme is an enum. What value should I assign? Starting with .2.17, the concept of extended enums was introduced. To put it simply, you can define constructors and methods like classes in enums. So let's modify the enum. Replace the comma at the end of doc with a semicolon. Define a toJSON that returns a string. Name is given as return value. Name is the string representation of the enum's value by default. Next is fromJSON. fromJSON receives JSON of string type and returns an enum value. If you use enum's values.byName function, it returns a fTheme member. Next, execute generate JSON serialization of .data class generate extension in theme state. Next, modify the toMap and themeState.fromMap functions. Modify toMap to toJSON and fTheme.toMap to fTheme.toJSON. Next, modify all fromMap to fromJSON and argument to JSON, and all maps in themeState instance are modified with JSON. Next, delete the toJSON and themeState.fromJSON factory constructor, and go to the top of the file and delete the .convert import. Next, let's apply hydrate mixing to theme block. Click on the light bulb and choose create two mixing overrides. Then two function templates were created. From the fromJSON function, it returns a theme state created from themeState.fromJSON. First, let's print out the JSON received as an argument. After saving the return value of theme state from JSON to the theme state variable, print it to the console before returning the value. Next, we return the theme state. At 2JSON, it returns the state converted to a map. Print the state received as an argument. After saving the return value of state.2JSON in the theme.json variable, print it to the console before returning the value. Next, we return theme.json. Let's do a hard restart and test. Let's press the plus and minus buttons a few times. Next, let's change the theme a few times. If you look at the console, you can see that counter.json and theme.json are being output. Whenever the state changes, it is saved in the storage in the form of JSON. Let's do a hard restart. State has been maintained, and if you look at the console, you can see the theme state and count state converted from JSON read from storage. Here, after pressing the clear button, let's hard restart. You can check that it has been reset to the initial state. With this, we learned about Hydrate Block.